Right now, I'd like to introduce Robin, who's going to be monitoring the chat and also conducting the leading the question and answer period. So, Robin, want to introduce yourself?
I'm happy to do this, and I'm really eager to hear what we're going to hear about the American Revolution, having had taxation without representation, you know, kind of burned into my brain at about the age of 12. It'll be really interesting to hear some of the other underlying causes. And I have family on both sides. I have family who moved down from Milledgeville, Georgia to Lake City, Florida, and family from Massachusetts to New Jersey to Michigan to Nebraska.
Great.
Okay.
So please dive in. We'll be happy to hear what you have to say.
Okay. So this am I not muted yet? Okay. This series is a production of two different committees from the Unitarian Universal Society of San Francisco, the Human Rights Working Group and Forum. For more information about the work of our committees or for information about the speakers, you can access our website, which is uusf.org, or email us at humanrights@uusf.org or forum@uusf.org. All those links are in the chat if you want to just cut and paste. And now, before we begin the program, we will take a moment to honor the first peoples who occupied the land where this program is taking place. And I'm going to introduce David, who will take that forward. Thank you, David.
Thank you, Bruce. My name is David Heilbrunn. Today, we, the members of the First Unitarian Universalist Society of San Francisco, gratefully acknowledge that we are located on the ancestral home of the Ramaytush Ohlone peoples who inhabited what is now the San Francisco Peninsula. The Greater Bay Area is also the ancestral territory of the Miwok, Yokuts, Patwin, and other Ohlone tribes. Indigenous communities have lived in and moved through this area, anthropologists say, for over 10,000 years. We further recognize that as the original stewards of this land, the Ohlone understood the interconnectedness of all things and maintained harmony with all of nature for a millennia. We honor them for their enduring commitment to our Mother Earth. As the indigenous stewards of this land and in accordance with their traditions, these tribes have never ceded, lost, or forgotten their responsibilities as caretakers of this land. As guests, we recognize that we benefit from living and working on their traditional homelands. We now wish to pay our respects by acknowledging these indigenous inhabitants and by affirming their sovereign rights as First Peoples. Please join us in a few moments of silence to acknowledge and honor these ancestors. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. By way of introduction, I'd like to say a few words about what motivated our committees to present this series on US history at this time. But before I do that, I'm going to sing an American cultural treasure theme from the musical South Pacific related to our subject today. You've got to be taught to hate and fear. You've got to be taught from year to year. It's got to be drummed in your dear little ear. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be taught to be afraid of people whose eyes are oddly made and people whose skin is a different shade. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be taught before it's too late, before you are 6 or 7 or 8, to hate all the people your relatives hate. You've got to be carefully taught. Today, we know that the racially motivated killings in Buffalo are evidence of an American cultural conditioning. Our vaunted governmental and educational systems seem to be failing us. It's become apparent that there are concerted efforts to outlaw the truth from being told in classrooms about the history of this country, and especially the history of indigenous and enslaved peoples and Asian peoples. This effort further wants to punish those who tell the truth. Most evident are restrictions on curricula and book banning in our public schools. In 2021, 14 state legislatures passed bills to curtail the teaching of certain concepts, such as critical race theory and sexism. The truth is that CRT is a false target, for it is only taught in universities and law schools. In the pipeline are at least 36 states working on laws or policies to restrict teaching about racism, white supremacy, while others are working to encourage teaching this history. New academic initiatives to unearth and learn from our cultural history are deemed harmful to our young people when the opposite is true. Those who profit culturally and economically from a false history want to stop the truth from being told to preserve the current unjust status quo. We must be aware and challenge these undemocratic attitudes. This is why our two committees decided to produce this series, which we ironically call Dangerous Truths. We hope this small effort will help shed light on our true history. We are very pleased now to introduce a speaker, Professor Woody Holton, who is the McCausland Professor of History at the University of South Carolina. He is the author of the book, Abigail Adams, which won the Bancroft Prize, and author of another book, Unruly Americans and the Origins of the Constitution, a finalist in the National Book Award. His latest book, Liberty is Sweet, The Hidden History of the American Revolution, really caught our interest when we started this series. We were especially elated with the review of your book by Nicole Hannah-Jones of the New York Times, who, as we know, created the award-winning 1619 Project, who said, and I quote, "Hidden history decenters the almost exclusive white revolutionary narratives that we've been taught. Instead, it makes visible the influence and agency of Black and Indigenous peoples, as well as white women, who together played such a critical role in creating this multiracial nation, and shows once again how the simplistic histories of our founding failed to explain our divided country in which we all live," unquote. So welcome, Professor Holton. Thank you for coming today.
Thank you so much, Dolores. And I want to ask both you and Dave a favor of please email me a copy of what you said, both about the efforts to suppress Black history and Dave's dedication to your hosts. My hosts are the Catawba people, many of whom are still here in much confined area of just north of me on Interstate 77. But I really appreciate what both of you said. And I wanted to respond real quick, Dolores, that South Carolina was one of the states that was targeted for, there was a bill to ban the 1619 Project in our schools. And they got rid of that early on, but then there were still other horrible provisions targeting at transgender kids and at Black history and other things. And just 3 days ago, our legislature adjourned without adopting that bill. Of all places, South Carolina stood up to the book banners, and I played this big a role in that I'm very proud of. But the biggest roles were the NAACP, Legal Defense Fund, the American Library Association, and most of all, South Carolina teachers, who, as you know, they wake up at 5 or 6 a.m. to go teach, but then they were there at 5 and 6 and 8 p.m. testifying to that committee and made it very hard for that bill to pass. And it was really the teachers who stopped it. And I'm extremely proud of my own kids, public school teachers, who were part of that effort. So I really appreciate the invitation. I love the concept dangerous truth. So let me make my effort in that direction. And I'm going to go ahead and share my screen by pushing these three buttons successfully, I hope. I'm going to talk about the influence primarily of two groups on the American Revolution, Native Americans and African Americans. And I want to say real briefly at the outset, well, first I want to say I'm going to finish at 2 o'clock your time, 43 minutes from now, even if I'm in the middle of a sentence, because I can tell this is a group where I'm not going to have to beg for questions and conversations. So I really want to hear from you as much as me. And I'll stop sooner if you want me to, but is two o'clock your time a good time? 43 minutes? Okay. So I'm going to talk about Native Americans and African Americans, and we could talk about how horrendously the American Revolution ended, especially for Native Americans. They suffered more than anybody as a result of the revolution, that is so many of the nations driven off of their land. And then African Americans suffered, many of them, because when natives were driven off their land in the South, what we now call the Southeast, then African Americans were sent south to populate their lands, to work their land in the 19th century. But I'm not going to focus on either group's victimization today, because my own personal angle of interest in indigenous people and African Americans in the revolution is the surprising fact that both of those groups heavily influenced both the decision on the part of people you've all heard of, like Washington and Jefferson, to declare independence, and then also the course of the war that followed, that we call the American War of Independence. So they were not just victims, they exerted a huge influence on others as well. And actually, I can start with the issue that Robin mentioned, taxation without representation. You guys may remember that the Stamp Act was one of the first grievances. It was really Parliament who wanted to change the relationship with white colonists. White colonists knew they had it pretty good, but Parliament was tired of paying for wars between the colonists and Native Americans. And so in 1763, Parliament drew a line along the crest of the Appalachian Mountains, where our Appalachian Trail is today, equivalent to your Pacific Crest Trail. Parliament drew that line and told the colonists, you can't go west of this line. And I'd love to be able to tell you that Parliament did that out of humanitarian interest in not taking further land from Native Americans, because they're people just like us. That was not the motive, however. The motive was that Parliament understood something we often forget today, and that is the most expensive thing the government ever does is go to war. And Parliament in 1763, when they drew this blue line, had just finished a 9 years long war that we call the 7 Years' War, against France and Spain and lots of native nations. And so the purpose of this line was to keep Britain out of another war against Native Americans. And so the line itself infuriated a lot of people that we've heard of, like George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, because it told them, you can't go steal land west of that land, of that line. And that's grievous. Washington said the greatest estates we have in this colony, Virginia, he meant, were made by taking up the rich back lands. And he'd made his fortune by marrying a rich widow, Martha Custis, but he wanted to make more. And that would be by taking land from the Indians. And this proclamation line cut him off from that. And to enforce that line, Parliament made an extraordinary decision, something he'd never done before. And that is, having just finished a war against France and the Indians, it left behind 10,000 troops. So if you look at my map closely, near New York, you see the two big rectangles that I'm circling my cursor over. The big ones represent regiments, and the smaller ones represent companies. 10,000 troops altogether, and the majority of them on the frontier, places that you know, like Niagara there, Detroit. This map maker put Detroit in the wrong place. It's actually to the west of those straits that it's named after, but the furthest west ones were out here on the Mississippi River, a bunch in western South Carolina, not far from where I am right now. And in a sense, you could call these peacekeeping troops, because that was their goal. Yes, to protect the colonists from indigenous warriors, but also to protect indigenous people from being attacked by the colonists, because Parliament didn't want to make indigenous people so mad that they would go to war again. And so as the annual register, a newspaper at the time put it, those troops were there to awe and protect the Indians. And then the question came up, who's gonna pay for keeping 10,000 troops in America? And Parliament quite rationally said, well, the colonists should pay for that. And that's when Parliament adopted the Stamp Act. So we have this thing that we're all familiar with, the Stamp Act, no taxation without representation. But the story behind the story is, had there been no indigenous people, there would have been no Stamp Act. Does that make sense? Okay, so let me follow that story forward. That line went up in 1763. That's when the troops were left there. Stamp Act was 1765. The colonists got, through rioting, got that repealed. We still have these colonists wanting to take over that Western land. The Virginia House of Burgesses in 1769 had a lot of members that you've heard of, like Jefferson and Washington and Patrick Henry. And they met at the Virginia Capitol, which we only have a diagram of. There's a restoration in Williamsburg that looks nothing like the original, but they met in this Capitol building and sent a petition to the British government saying, get rid of this blue line, lift the gate, and let us go take this land from our indigenous, from the indigenous people. So that was in 1769, but I want to tell you something else that happened in that same year, 1769. And for that, let me advance, enlarge that map again. Because look where I'm going to put a blue dot. That's out there on currently the border between Indiana and Illinois. It's the Wabash River, as in the Wabash Cannonball, where the female peace chiefs, in these Native nations, you had four kinds of chiefs, male war chiefs and male peace chiefs, but also female war chiefs and female peace chiefs. And this fourth group, the female peace chiefs, in 1769, started in a diplomatic initiative to get all of the nations in what we now call the Midwest, the Miamis and the Delawares and the Shawnees and the Ojibwe Chippewa and so forth, plus some of the southern nations who had been their enemies for years, Native nations like the Cherokees. What these Native women initiated in 1769, the same year as that petition from the House of Burgesses, these Native women initiated a grand coalition of all these Native nations to resist the colonists trying to take their land and to try to keep that blue line in force. And the British government found out what these Native women sachems were up to. And here's one of the most amazing things I'll tell you today is that faced with two things coming in 1769, coming to London. On the one hand, people like Washington and Jefferson want to take more land from the Native people. On the other hand, the Native people have started organizing this grand coalition of Indian nations to resist that encroachment on their land. faced with that, the British government did not want another war against the Native Americans. And so it ignored George Washington and Thomas Jefferson and all those other Virginia leaders and listened to the Native women and decided to stand by that land, that line. They call it the Proclamation Line of 1763. And the British government never repealed it. In fact, in Canada, which of course didn't rebel, that line is still in effect. The other policies as part of that proclamation of 1763 are still in effect. And the only thing that abolished it down here was, of course, the American Revolution. So there's one way in which Native people helped bring on the war. But I also want to tell you that once the war got going, Native people massively helped influence it. This is a map from my book showing, for the first time, I was really proud of this, worked it out with this great map maker, that in 1780, Native people, in conjunction with the British, who had forts at Niagara, Michilimackinac, Detroit, and so forth, launched a multi-pronged attack into New York, what's now Western Pennsylvania, down into Kentucky. They attacked a British fort called Vincennes. They even attacked St. Louis, it had been a British fort, but had been captured by the Americans at Vincennes. And then this Anglo-Indian war party also attacked St. Louis, which was a Spanish town and fort at the time. And you might remember that Spain was an informal ally of the U.S. in the Revolutionary War. And on the other side of the Mississippi River, they attacked Cahokia. This is one of many Native American attacks during the Revolutionary War, but I wanted to point this one out in particular because it showed the extent to which Native Americans won the war in the West. That is, while Cornwallis and other British generals were surrendering in the East, in the West, the Native Americans did a great job of defending themselves and kept the colonists, people like Daniel Boone out in Kentucky, kept them back on their heels, and in a sense won the war in the West. And the only place they lost was at the peace treaty table in 1783 when the British essentially sold them out. And the British signed over all that land out to the Mississippi River, signed it over to their former colonies, now the United States. And the Native nations just ignored that and they continued fighting, but without British help. They got a little British help in the War of 1812, but once that war was over and they had no British help, then they did it. Most of the Native nations had to withdraw, although there were people like the Catawbas, my neighbors here, who hung on. So Native American nations both helped bring on the Revolutionary War. The Declaration of Independence mentions taxation without representation once, but it mentions Native people and their land three times, and they really played a crucial role in the war itself. And we can say the same thing about African Americans. Many of you may know one of the first American painters to make it big, John Singleton Copley. And here is a portrait he did at the time of the Revolution. I like showing it to people because I think you'll agree with me that it's astonishingly unracist, given that it was the 18th century. He's painting a person. Now, the racist part is in the fact that he didn't bother to write down the man's name in a way that survived. So it just has to be titled anonymously. But racism wasn't inevitable. There were people who could, even white people, who could see the humanity of others. This is a detail of another painting by Copley, an African-American soldier, one of what turned out to be almost 10,000 African-Americans who escaped to the British side. You can see this man is fighting on the side of the redcoats, although he was a servant, so he wasn't wearing a red coat, but he was certainly fighting just like everybody else in this battle. And it by fighting for their own freedom, African-Americans helped also influence the American Revolution. I mentioned taxes, I mentioned territory. The colonists were not the ones who wanted change. It was British who were trying to stop the territorial expansion of their colonists. It was the British who were who were trying to tax the colonists and so forth. It was, you really have to understand the revolution as colonists on defense and the British government on offense. Okay, so let's talk about Africa. Where I left us is that the British were trying to change things and the colonists were not. Since you got to sing Dolores, I'm gonna sing by a famous Californian. All the colonists wanted to do was to go back to the way we were. That is, white colonists were quite happy with the status quo of 1762, just wanted to turn back the clock to that. No, it was Parliament that wanted to change things, but as they battled over those issues, it came to war, as everybody knows, in April of 1775 in Massachusetts at Lexington and Concord. But I want to take you now down to the largest of the British colonies in North America at the time. You Californians forget you weren't always the biggest state. Virginia was in 1775. And the governor of Virginia, you can see his name at the very bottom right there of this proclamation. His name was Dunmore, and he was vastly outnumbered. That is, he had very few British troops with him. There were Americans, white Americans, who were loyal to the crown, but not very many in his state of Virginia. So he needed manpower. And so he issued this proclamation, which I won't ask you to read, but I'll just tell you, it's an emancipation proclamation in many ways similar to the one that Lincoln would issue in 1863, only he issued it 47 years later, earlier than that. That is in 1775, November 15th, 1775 is when he actually released it. And it says three ifs. If you are enslaved by one of the rebels, that is, Governor Dunmore had slaves of his own that he was not proposing to free, but if you're owned by Jefferson or Washington or Patrick Henry or any of the other rebels, and in fact, all three of those men did have enslaved people who escaped them, joined the British and got free fighting for them during the Revolutionary War. So Dunmore says, if you're owned by a rebel, if you're able and willing to bear arms, which sounds like an appeal only to men, although it turns out that half the people who joined Governor Dunmore were women and children. So if you're owned by a rebel, able and willing to bear arms, and the biggest if of all was if you can get to my army, then I will put a musket in your hands and I will free you. And over the course of the war, nearly 10,000 African-Americans fought for the British and achieved their freedom in that way. And you were talking, Dolores, about some of the past controversies. We've got a new controversy coming because Congress is about to vote to put up a new statue, a new monument on the National Mall to Black patriots, that is, Blacks who fought in the Revolutionary War. And the controversy that I can tell you is coming is, are we only going to commemorate Blacks who fought in the Revolutionary War on the American side, or will we also commemorate those who fought on the British side? I'm for commemorating both, because whichever side they fought on, they fought for freedom. But we can talk about that in a few minutes. What I want to ask you guys to imagine right now is, imagine that you're not one of those African-Americans who escaped and became free by fighting for the British, but imagine yourself in an uncomfortable position. Imagine yourself as one of the enslavers. Imagine your attitude towards Governor Dunmore. His number one job is to protect the slaveholders from their slaves and from Native American attacks and from a foreign attack. But he's there to protect white people. That's who the British Empire was for. And here he is doing just the opposite. That is, as one white Virginian said, by issuing this Emancipation Proclamation, Governor Dunmore is aiming a dagger at our throat through the hands of our slaves. And literally hundreds of other white people in Virginia and in other colonies expressed, we've got the documents, expressed their tremendous anger at the British for basically forming an informal alliance with Blacks. They were so furious that this helped persuade many whites in the South to go from just wanting to go back to the way things were to wanting to go ahead and declare independence. And so if you read the Declaration of Independence, the bulk of it is devoted to these 27 grievances against the king. And I don't have a PowerPoint with the 27 grievances to ask you to read. Just read the last one and I'll give it to you in 7 words. It says, oh, actually, I think I have it here somewhere. No, I don't. The Declaration of Independence, the last 7 words of the first 7 words of the last grievance, sort of the focus of the grievances, is referring to the king. He has excited domestic insurrection amongst us, meaning that the king has stirred up our slaves against us. Now, in saying it that way, the Continental Congress and Declaration of Independence kind of got the motion wrong, because actually African-Americans like this man had been appealing to the British for more than a year when Governor Dunmore finally issued his Emancipation Proclamation. And that's important for us to know that they had some agency and some empowerment in this. They weren't just led by the British. If anybody was a puppet, it was the British. And you can see that if you look, any of you who are Twitter users, if you go to that hashtag countdown to 1619, Nicole Hannah-Jones made that point in the 1619 Project and was pilloried for it. But it's literally true that one of the grievances, not the only one by any means, one of the grievances that pushed the white colonists over the edge into wanting to declare independence was their anger at the British for forming an alliance with their slaves. So I mentioned that about 10,000 Blacks fought on the British side in the Revolutionary War, but about 10,000 fought on the American side as well, mostly in the North, because in the South, the whites wouldn't allow their slaves to fight in the Continental Army, but they did up North. The first couple of years, lots of whites signed up, but then war weariness set in, and then they were quite happy to have Black soldiers sign up in the Northern states. And around New York City, 1 in 5 people were enslaved. So they were there, not in the same numbers in the South, but they were there. And one of those, actually a mixed race soldier in the Continental Army in 1776, was this man, Lemuel Haynes, who your group, I think, will be especially interested in, because you can correct me on my church history, but I think the Unitarian faith began as obviously it's multifaceted now, but it began as an offshoot of the Congregational Church. That is the group that used to be called the Puritans by its enemies. The first Puritan minister who was not white was this man, Lemuel Haynes. Long before that, Lemuel Haynes in 1776 was a soldier in the Continental Army. And he wrote a pamphlet, and you might better make out, even though it's handwritten here, it wasn't published at his time, might be able to make out at the top there, "Liberty Further Extended." That was the title of his pamphlet. And or "Free Thoughts on Illegality of Slave Keeping." That is, this, while he's sitting around the campfire at night, he, as a soldier and fighting for our freedom, he said everyone should be free. And so this was an anti-slavery pamphlet that Lemuel Haynes wrote. And what's especially significant about this pamphlet is the epigraph. You remember epigraph, if you're writing a book, you might start it off with a especially relevant quotation. And he was writing this pamphlet in 1776. He got a copy of the Declaration of Independence. And so of course his epigraph was, next to my cursor there, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal." And in quoting that phrase, Lemuel Haynes became the first person to ever quote that phrase from the Declaration of Independence. And let me tell you why that's so important, because initially the Declaration of Independence was not about equality. Yes, they had that line, but for Jefferson, when he wrote that phrase, that was almost a throwaway line, because he was making his way to a principle. He was saying, of course, we're all born equal and we have certain rights. And one of those rights is a life, liberty, and happiness. But if government doesn't support that right, then we have the right to overthrow the government. And that was his focus, was that colonies, if your country and my country, if we're in an alliance, you're allowed to break off an alliance like that. In a sense, the Declaration of Independence, as originally written, was a states' rights document, a secession document, saying that these 13 colonies, part of the British Empire, have the right to secede from the British Empire. And sure enough, you could see that when people quoted the Declaration of Independence, white people, free people quoted it for the first three or four decades of its existence into the 19th century. When they quoted it, they quoted the secession phrases where Jefferson asserts the right of one body of people to secede from another. But Lemuel Haynes became the first person to quote all men are created equal, but not the last. Other people fighting slavery, especially Quakers and African-Americans, like many of you have heard of Benjamin Banneker, who helped design Washington, D.C., a black man. He wrote a letter to Thomas Jefferson against slavery and quoting Jefferson's own words back to him, all men are created equal. And so a literary scholar at the University of Chicago named Eric Slaughter discovered that the vast majority of the people who quoted all men are created equal for the rest of the 18th century, that is from 1776 right up until the end of the century in 1799, the vast majority of the people who quoted the Declaration, who quoted that phrase, all men are created equal, were anti-slavery people, both African-Americans and their white supporters. And then when we get into the 19th century, anti-slavery people continue to quote all men are created equal, but it also gets picked up by another freedom-seeking group, and that was women, especially women seeking the right to vote. So that the culmination of that process comes in 1848, when Elizabeth Cady Stanton writes the Seneca Falls Declaration, and that declaration begins, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men and women are created equal. My point about this is, I told you before how African-Americans, like Native Americans, helped bring about the Declaration of Independence by forming this alliance with the British that made whites so mad. But they, African-Americans also transformed the meaning of the Declaration of Independence. What began as a secession document was transformed by people like Lemuel Haynes into a universal declaration of human rights. Let me say one more thing, and then we can all talk. Like Native Americans, African Americans both helped get the Revolutionary War going and then played a really crucial role in the war itself. And I could cite you literally more than a dozen examples, but I'll just use one since it's near where I'm coming to you from, down in Savannah, Georgia. You may remember that Savannah River is the border between my state of South Carolina and Georgia to the south of us. Well, in 1778, the British resolved to capture Savannah, which was the capital of Georgia at the time, to capture Savannah from the Americans. And so they sent Archibald Campbell, a lieutenant colonel, down with 3,000 men to do that. He landed successfully over here, but then to get to Savannah, he was going to have to get past this line of South Carolina and Georgia troops. And they placed themselves very well, that is, between two swamps on their two flanks. You probably know that armies, even today, you're really vulnerable on the sides, on the flanks. And you can really defend yourself, or at least cause your attackers a lot of damage if they have to come at you head on. And so the Americans, give them credit, had arranged in themselves so they would have to come head on. But instead of coming out, instead of that is, if the British had to come head on rather than outflanking them, and they couldn't outflank them because, as I just showed with the red box moving there, because of those swamps. And actually, Lieutenant Colonel Campbell climbed up a tree and surveyed the battlefield and basically said, "Oh damn, because I'm going to have to attack frontally. I'll win because I've got three times as many men, but I may lose half of them in doing so by this frontal assault." As he got ready to launch his frontal assault, a Black man came and tapped him on the shoulder and said, actually, I know of a secret path through that swamp where you can get around the American line. And that's what, I'll show you the box again, that's what Colonel Campbell did. He led his light infantry around, attacking the Americans from behind, creating absolute chaos within the American side. And it turned out that the British captured Savannah easily without huge casualties. And that story was repeated throughout the war, where African Americans played the crucial role. For instance, Stony Point, New York, it was an African American named Pompey who played the same exact role, but he was fighting on the American side and helped them capture Stony Point with many fewer casualties than they would have had if he hadn't, because he had been selling eggs to the British garrison at Stony Point for years. For months. And so they were used to him. And so the Americans came with him, sort of hiding behind him. Or these are my buddies, they're carrying eggs too. And they captured the sentries and were able to attack Stony Point in the same way. And I pointed out 10,000 African Americans on both sides. One of the ways we need to understand the American Revolutionary War is that it was an African-American civil war, because African Americans fought on both sides, as did Native Americans. Last thing I'll say is, of course, I'm promoting my book to you, but I want you to focus on the one American in this picture. You've got these two British soldiers on horses. They're carrying a message. This is a lithograph from the 19th century, but it's depicting a scene that happened in 1780 or 81. Near where I am here in South Carolina. These British cavalrymen were taking a message to a British general, but this American intercepted them with the pistol against their sabers, and they had firearms as well, and captured their message and sent it on to Nathaniel Greene, the former Quaker, who was the American commander in the South at the time. But this American has a secret. Let me zoom in and see if anybody can guess his secret. This would be a good time for you guys to go ahead and turn your microphones back on, because I'm done, except to see if anybody wants to weigh in on what they think this American soldier's secret might be. And it's the reason I put this image on the cover of my book to emphasize that I was trying to get at the hidden history. Who wants to weigh in and guess what this soldier's secret is?
Was she a woman?
That is, in fact, a woman who said, I'll stop sharing here so I can see who had that. Was that Veronica?
Yeah.
Well done. And somebody usually gets it, but not that fast. So my applause to you. What was it about that picture?
I saw her breast line.
You saw her breast line? Really? I got to bring her back up.
Yeah.
You think, okay.
Okay.
He has not
long hair. Tightly enough. Long hair.
Go ahead, sir.
Long hair was my clue.
I eventually saw the long hair, although I had to have it pointed out. Somebody else told me that they thought the hips were those of a female.
Oh, yeah.
That's a hard thing to hide, you know.
I think it's the leg also.
What's that?
The leg also, women's leg.
Woman's leg. Oh, that's interesting. Yeah. What's happened here, these two women had married two brothers named Martin, so we called them the Martin sisters, found out about these guys and intercepted them. My question about it was, well, wouldn't the pistol be all you needed? Why would you dress as men? So let me ask you that question as well, and I'll stop sharing again. But any idea why, and you can only see one of them in this is an inset from the picture book, or detail from the picture. But any idea why they would feel the need to dress as men? I've heard interesting answers to that. I'll see if anybody here has any.
Well, they wouldn't be attacked as women.
Of course.
Oh.
What's that? I didn't hear. You say that again. Go ahead, Dolores or Dave.
Well, but she, the woman who spoke, and I don't know who it was, but she said they would have been clearly attacked as women.
Oh, okay. I thought she said they wouldn't be attacked as women, but they had guns. But I think you've got a great point, Veronica. No, I think Veronica, you got a great point that such was the attitude of men towards women at the time that even if they'd had the guns, the men would have said, oh, you pretty little thing, you're not really going to use that pistol, and would have brushed away. And the reality probably was that they it's not like they were afraid to shoot, but they didn't want to kill anybody. And so maybe the men, so that was sort of part of the performance. You know, we've seen guns used for horrible things, including in Buffalo yesterday, but guns are often a performance. And it may have been that was part of the performance. Anybody else, you got any other explanations for why they dressed as men? I'll tell you the most.
Trying to disguise himself, and she wouldn't be identified. I don't know.
Well, I'm not sure who said that, but that was Bernie or Bruce, but I completely agree. And in fact, that leads me to tell you the rest of this story, because after capturing this message and sending it on, these two women went home. And then here's these two guys. I think the horses have been cut loose. And so it's late at night. They need a place to stay. So they knock on the first door they find. And guess whose door they knocked on? The Martins. And so these two women and an older woman who was their mother-in-law, Mrs. Martin, took them in for the night and heard their tale of woe about how they'd been captured by these two horrible men with pistols and had to give up their message. And oh, you poor dears, let us make you a cup of tea. And they never knew that they had taken refuge with the same people who had successfully attacked them. Now, this story was told in a couple of 19th century histories. It's almost too good to be true. I have a graduate assistant and I, we've been working so hard to find 18th century documentation to make it stronger. Maybe it's not true, but it was good enough for the cover of my book. Oh, I'll tell you one more possible reason why they wore the disguise that a woman pointed out to me that I never would have guessed, but her point was good. Women's dresses and skirts at the time went right to the ground. And so if you want to be mobile, you'll be more likely to dress like a man.
There's a All question right. from DJ.
Yes, Bernie, start us off.
DJ. Oh,
isn't that,
okay, yes. I have a prejudice. I'm from Detroit.
And you saw that my map had Detroit on the wrong side of Detroit.
Binational, yes. All right. This was we're speaking of a civil war that continued up to the American Civil War, when British Admiralty Courts oversaw American fleets, which were larger than the British Merchant Marine. I wanted to bring out three things. Sorry for preempting. The British East India Company was pulling off money for its Merchant Marine. Competition with the French in India, which lasted up to the time of Mountbatten in 1978. I'm particularly familiar with this. Secondly, is so-called Native Americans were very varied, if you like, in their origin and culture. Here in California, the Northern California coastal tribes speak a language base that goes to Finnish and Manchurian. They were very late land bridges. We're speaking of a high degree of diversity and culture and everything else. We're speaking really of a civil war that, because of slavery in the South, in effect, of the vice parliament, if you remember, Franklin would have stayed Tory if he had been granted his wish to be governor of Pennsylvania. And Washington's brother was an admiral in the British Navy.
Not an admiral, but he served with an admiral named Vernon, thus the name Mount Vernon, absolutely. And of course, Washington himself wanted to be a British officer. That's one of those great might have been. Suppose they'd given him a commission. He would have probably fought on the other side.
Right, I'm going to give you two tomes you might be familiar with. By Cash's Mind of the South, an homage to the Iroquois.
Oh, I know W.J. Cash, but I do not know Homage to the Iroquois. I'll look that up.
Well,
did you say it's a poem, and
their migrations to Algonquin in Ontario, in effect, having sided with the Americans for the British Indian War, in effect, and being pushed out by the colonists during the Revolution, in effect. The treaty that remained with the Iroquois in the among the Seneca was the oldest treaty made between a Congress and a foreign nation, which our American Supreme Court voided because it was too old.
Wow, that's one I did not know about. I do know that most of the Seneca fought on the British side, but you know, I mentioned that the Revolutionary War was in effect a civil war among African Americans. It was among Native Americans and even among the Iroquois, because the Oneidas and some of the Tuscaroras, who were part of the Iroquois Confederacy,
yes,
had been evangelized by Presbyterians, and they stuck with the Americans, while the rest of the Iroquois fought on the British side.
They moved to Algonquin.
What's that?
They went to Ontario, Algonquin, which is about 60 miles west of Hamilton.
Right. Since you mentioned India, I can't resist telling you guys one thing I didn't get into in my talk. You'd be familiar, Bernie, and maybe others as well, with Haider Ali, who was he wasn't officially a ruler, but he was in effect the ruler of a large part of India, and was in battles with the East India Company. And at one point they had to go to huge expense fighting Haider Ali. And to make up the expense, they persuaded Parliament to pass the Tea Act of 1773, which led directly to the Boston Tea Party, which led directly to the American Revolution. So there's a sense in which Haider Ali, 10,000 miles away in India, helped bring about the American Revolution. He also helped bring an end to it, because one reason the British threw in the towel when they did was that they were fighting Haider Ali in India at the same time that they were fighting Americans here, exactly. And they couldn't do that. And so in order to focus on India, which the British famously did in the 19th and 20th century, they gave up on the war here. So we owe it. I don't want to exaggerate the point, but in part, Haider Ali helped bring on the American Revolution and also bring an end to the American Revolution. I appreciate you bringing India into the discussion.
We are a commonwealth. We inherited British common law, which underlines our constitution.
Yes, yes. And I'm not so big on Alito's decision that we're going to read about more officially in June, but he talks all about the English common law in there. And actually, it's an interesting problem with law, because I'll say here, I'll make a controversial statement and let somebody disagree. But, you know, Alito argues that abortion has no history in America. And no matter how you feel about that issue, it's false. It has a long history in America, that they did not fool with it because they couldn't until quickening, which is about halfway through under the English common law. More importantly, Native women were practicing abortion for 40,000 years. African-American women did, as many of you have heard of Margaret Garner, who killed her own babies so they wouldn't remain slaves, but other women did that at a much more less painful time, that is before they were born. So if everybody counts as a person, we have a much longer history than Justice Alito wanted to recognize.
Shit, we know that.
Okay, I just wanted to give Bruce a chance to ask a question, which I think gets us into another area, and we don't want to drown in the detail of one part and not let other people.
Okay.
So Bruce asks, what's your opinion about the way the revolution is taught today in U.S. high schools?
I think it's getting better. And the best indication that it's getting better is that it's getting censored. Dolores talked about at the beginning. I still think that it'd be interesting to ask, because maybe I will ask for a show of hands from you guys about how many new about how many of you had previously heard before today about the thousands of African-Americans who fought on the British side in the Revolutionary War. I'll ask for a show of hands in a second, but just to make the point first, when I speak to Daughters of the American Revolution, which I...
Well, you're frozen there. Woody, you're frozen.
John talk, that's not years ago, but the point is people go, really? I've never heard that. And it's astonishing to me because a book comes out on that topic about once a year about Blacks who fought for the British. I can show you my syllabus, my bookshelf right behind me. This is just the books that I use every day. There's five or six just on that topic, just from the last few years. And yet it doesn't seem to break through. So Bruce, I would say many high school teachers are working very hard to get the whole story out there. They're confined by these state history standards. But even the state history standards are, I have to acknowledge, a lot better than they were. They're still not great, but they're better than they were. But the popular culture is still sort of out there. You know, the Denny's menu, that doesn't have the Black role or the Indigenous role in the Revolution. And so if we want to get the truth out, we've got to get it through museums and through the Denny's. If I could get control of the Denny's placemat, I can end racism in America, I think. Because that's where a lot of this, it's just in the popular culture. But again, I told some of the people who signed on early with me that I was just at Fort Sumter where the Civil War began yesterday, and the guide never mentioned any of the old fake ideology of the Confederacy. He said this war was about slavery. Enslavers rebelled in order to keep enslaving people. And I just wanted to hug him because you couldn't have heard that at Fort Sumter 10 years ago. And if you can hear it there, then certainly you can hear it anywhere. But I don't know, Bruce, you're not a teacher yourself, are you?
I retired. Retired teacher, but I didn't teach history, though. I taught other things.
I have a friend right on the other side of the bay from you named Ray Raphael, who was a high school history teacher for many years in the Bay Area and now writes history books that are, I like them because they're similar to mine, but I think you guys would like them too because they do try to tell the whole story. Ray Raphael liked the painting.
Well, we also have Roxanne Dunbar Ortiz, who's done tremendous work in exposing the truth about all this stuff. So I don't know if she wants to say anything or not. But anyway, she's here.
Yeah, I'd love to hear from you, Roxanne.
Roxanne? There she is.
Hi.
Thank you.
Hi. Well, thank you. That was amazing. I have the book, but I haven't read it yet. I've read several reviews, and I really think it's important. It does things that most books don't, you know, just tell the truth. Pretty simple. Just what the documents say and the truth, you know, all of it, and not skipping this and that. So I really appreciate it. I'm working now a lot on the Northwest Ordinance, and I wonder if you'd say something about that. If it's in your book? I don't know if you.
I mentioned it very briefly, but I want to make sure that you have run into a book called The Alchemy of Slavery by Scott Herman, Herman. He and I went to an alchemy exhibit together while we were in Los Angeles for a year, and he got taken with that title, Alchemy of Slavery, which I do like, but I wanted him to call his book Slave State, because it's a history of slavery in Illinois, which, of course, is one of the states covered by the Northwest Ordinance, and people think there were never slaves after 1787 in Illinois, but they found ways to make exceptions. And so Abraham Lincoln spent time in court trying to free enslaved people in Illinois who were enslaved decades after the Northwest Ordinance. Although I think Scott told me that he also, Abraham Lincoln, sometimes also appeared on the other side on behalf of slaveholders still trying to keep slaves. And so I would really recommend Scott's book about that, because of, we think of the Northwest Ordinance as, in a sense, it does pave the way for the Civil War, because you have this official line of separation along the Ohio River, but that's what the official situation, and as you know from writing your wonderful Indigenous People's History of the U.S., what's official is not what happens on the ground.
I have a question of the imperialism that is so clearly stated in the Northwest Ordinance to reach the Pacific, and the maps that they had, you know, making from Maine to what's now the Pacific Northwest, and right. You know, when they were still a confederacy instead of a nation state, each one was autonomous. So when they're writing that, which is prior to the Constitution, they were actually looking to get to the Pacific and then to China trades. So that imperialism that's built into the Northwest Ordinance, I think, is something that, Jeff Osler deals with, you know, the colonialism part. That's easy to deal with, the colonization of the Native people. But the imperialism, I think it's just very important to understand that U.S. imperialism started with the beginning of the United States.
Or even sooner, I'd say, because I was born in Virginia, and Virginia, by its charter of 1609, goes all the way to the Pacific. And so the imperial pretensions back when, you know, and I've just been listening to a book on tape, Bernard Bailey's last book, the first Jamestown settlement, it was, I think they had 100 and some people when they started. And by the time the resupply ship arrived, they were down to 38. Yeah. Most of them had starved or died of disease because they established in a malaria swamp. But many others had just given up and gone to live with the Powhatans, the local indigenous tribe. And yet there they are holding their charter, saying that we go all the way to the Pacific. And a friend of mine who teaches at the University of Denver talks about the Continental Congress. You know, when they first met in 1774, they proclaimed themselves the Continental Congress, even though they controlled less than a sixth, I think about 15% of the land area that's now the continental United States, not even including Alaska and Hawaii. So they, you know, it's that line, dress for the job you want, and they sure drew the maps for the nation they wanted rather than the nation that they had.
Woody, I'd like to just follow up on what Roxanne said. Did Thomas Jefferson, when he sent Lewis and Clark to the Northwest, did he have that in mind too? Next month we're going to have our next speaker is going to be Robert J. Miller, professor of law at Lewis and Clark, and his latest book is Native America: Discovered and Conquered, Thomas Jefferson, Lewis and Clark, and Manifest Destiny. So when Thomas Jefferson, I mean, I'm just wondering if you know anything, did he have it in mind? That's why he sent Lewis and Clark to the Northwest to investigate.
Ultimately, yes, because I mean, the amazing thing about Lewis and Clark's expedition is that Jefferson initiated it before the Louisiana Purchase. You could think, okay, if they've just made this purchase, of course, yeah, well, let's go see how far our new land is, because we're supposedly owning all the land that drains into the Mississippi River. So let's go see what we got here, even though, of course, they didn't have it because it was still fully inhabited and fully controlled by Native people. But he didn't even wait for the Louisiana Purchase. And remember, the Louisiana Purchase was a surprise that he sent people over there to buy New Orleans, which is on the east side of the Mississippi River, not to quash French title. You know, and the United States owes the Louisiana Purchase to the slave rebels in Saint-Domingue, who turned Saint-Domingue into Haiti, because after that had happened and the French were unable to reclaim it mostly because of yellow fever and because of Black freedom fighters, then the French didn't need Louisiana anymore. And that's why they sold their, it was a faulty title, of course, from the beginning, just like what Roxanne was talking about. But my point is that Jefferson didn't know and couldn't know that Louisiana Purchase was coming when he sent Lewis and Clark west. And Roxanne, do you want to comment on that as well?
Yeah, that, you know, the timing is really important. Also, the other I call them spies, Lewis and Clark. They basically were spying on and drawing maps and mapping out the tribes that existed, and then the what's the other one, into Mexico? What's it called? Who were they called? Anyway, the Jefferson also sent two spies into Mexican, into Spanish territory.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, there's a book about them called Jefferson and Southwestern Exploration. I can't remember what those guys' names were, but I know you're talking about. Yeah, that's true.
There's a mountain. There's a mountain named after, what's that mountain in Colorado?
I'm about to find out because I remember, and I but I don't remember, so I'll get it.
Not Zebulon Pike.
Pike. Zebulon Pike, right?
Pike's Peak.
Anyway, that was, they were already mapping out to take Mexico, you know, when Spain left. And in 1821, when Spain, when after the 10-year War of Independence in Mexico, that's when the slavers moved into Tejas, into Texas, the Mexican territory. So I think, you know, from the very beginning, you see these things that are just left out of history, you know, the connection. So it's good to see you doing, it right.
Thanks. That book I mentioned, Jefferson and Southwest Exploration, the author is Dan Flores. And I remember reading that years ago. It's a fantastic book. I'll stick it in the chat.
I have one more question, and then I'll shut up and let Larry has a good, I wants to ask you a question. But one more thing I've often wondered, why isn't credit, or maybe I'm wrong, why isn't credit given to the successful slave rebellion in Haiti that forced the French to sell to the United, maybe I'm oversimplifying it, but it really forced the French, they needed a lot of money, so they sold, the quote Louisiana Purchase in 1803 to the United States for, was it $15 million? I mean, what do you think of that? Isn't that true? It's because of the successful Black slave rebellion in Haiti that we acquired all that land.
Yes. As I mentioned, there was one other factor as well, and that is when Napoleon sent troops to reclaim Saint-Domingue and re-enslave all of those people, they were just destroyed by yellow fever. And so I'd say it was the U.S. owes the Louisiana Purchase to those two factors. The first, the fact that African Americans on Saint-Domingue rebelled starting in 1791, and then second, to the fact that Napoleon wasn't able to recapture it. Obviously, they were fighting for their lives and their freedom, and so that makes them good fighters, just like Ukrainians today. But also, they had yellow fever on their side, and so I would count that factor in too.
Thank you.
So I had a question. I wondered, about a month ago, PBS did this series on Benjamin Franklin. I wondered if you had seen that and whether that fits with your, I think it took place a few years after what you're talking about here in American history, and I wonder how all that fit in.
I'm sorry, I have not seen the Ben Franklin series yet. I want to, and I've seen some criticism online, but not enough to have an opinion.
It's all about the him going to France to get France to help them fight the Revolutionary War. And
my guess about, I shouldn't guess since I haven't seen one frame, but you know, Ken Burns is wonderful as a cinematographer, but he does tend to focus on individuals. And I mean, historians do generally. And actually, when I was talking to somebody previously about pop culture, you know, there, HBO did a series on John Adams, which sort of made it sound like he single-handedly initiated and then won the Revolutionary War, which is ironic because Adams' great anxiety was that historians would represent George Washington as single-handedly starting and winning the Revolutionary War. And so he got to get all the credit. And so my point about France is, not having seen the movie, I could tell you, yes, Franklin was a great diplomat, much better than John Adams, who went over there and pissed the French off over and over again. But that was what Bismarck would, I think it was he who coined the term realpolitik. That is, the French wanted to weaken their enemies, the British. And so it was very much in their interest to be on our side. So I think even if we had sent a terrible diplomat over there, then I think the French would have supported the war. And again, that's not to put down Franklin's role, but had it not been in their interest, there's no amount of charm that Ben Franklin could have exerted that would have brought the French into that alliance. And for instance, they never got the Spanish. The Spanish recognized American independence after the British did. And you can understand why, because whereas the British had 26 colonies in America, 13 of which rebelled, and you know what the other 13 are, the two Floridas that didn't rebel, the Canadian provinces like Nova Scotia and Quebec, and Prince Edward Island didn't rebel, Bahamas, Bermuda, and then the Caribbean. The British had 26 colonies here, but the Spanish had even more, and certainly even more valuable because they had silver mines. And so they didn't want to encourage more rebellions by helping this one succeed, although they sort of unofficially allied with the Americans. So I want to see it, and my skepticism is that he's going to exaggerate, that Ken Burns is going to exaggerate the role of that one guy, but we'll have to hear from other people who have. And I see Bernie behind you. Is there anybody who hasn't, anybody who wanted to ask a question who hadn't had a first one yet? Then let's go to Bernie.
Very quickly, cultural underpinnings of the Great Revolution begins in the 14th century with settlement, in effect, smoked cod for the Catholic Church Fridays in Maine, of course, and along the coast. In effect, people have been coming here. If you remember, the Good Pilgrims were met by someone who spoke perfectly good Spanish and English, who had worked in London.
Right.
We didn't come out of nowhere. In effect, legality took over what had already existed.
Yes, a lot of people believe that Columbus was not even the first European. We, of course, know that it wasn't.
By far.
The first, I mean, and obviously, and of course, I'm not even talking about Vikings, but I'm talking, there are a lot of people in Bristol, England, who make the case that their fisher people had gone ashore of Labrador and Newfoundland and so forth to dry their fish before 1492. I mean, obviously that's a pointless debate because people had been here for 50,000 years or so by then. But there's another place where the fish trade is really important. We are told that by the 16th century, one out of every 3 days in the calendar were saints' days, meaning the only meat you could eat was fish. And so fish was a huge part of people's diet. And a couple of people have written about the role of fish in the American Revolution because the Americans, you know, the number one export of Massachusetts was fish. And the number one place they exported it to was the Caribbean. And the number one islands that they sold those fish to were not British islands, but French and Spanish islands, which were still Catholic and still wanted fish. They took what they literally called the refuse fish for enslaved people in the Caribbean. the better fish, you know, that had been more successfully preserved went to Portugal and Spain, but the refuse fish went to French Islands and the Caribbean. And then the people, these merchants from New England, as far south as Pennsylvania, in return for that fish, took molasses, and that was illegal under the British. And the British really tried to crack down on that. Remember, I said the British cracked down on taxes and territory. I like to talk about the four T's: taxes, territory, trade would be the third big one, and that is this illegal trade. Fish headed from the mainland down to the Caribbean in return for molasses coming north, French molasses coming north. And that's trading with the enemy, because the French and the British were at war for much of the 18th century. And the fourth T, which we don't have to get into, but those of you who get to the book will see this: treasury bills, that is paper money, the money supply was a huge part of this story as well.
I thought you were going to say tobacco, but no.
I could have said tobacco. I put that under trade, but yeah, I meant to start saying the five T's, because Jefferson was furious. The one asterisk to my saying that white colonists were pretty happy in 1762 with the British Empire, and it was the Parliament that wanted to change things, the one asterisk to that was Jefferson was not happy, people, other tobacco growers, because 85% of their tobacco ended up on the European continent, but 100% of it had to go to Britain first and then be taken off the ship. And the guys taking the ship off, they were massively underpaid. So they'd drill a little hole in the barrel and take a handful and stick it in their pocket at the risk of being executed, and put in a warehouse, and then put back on the ship, a different ship, by somebody else who also takes a handful, and the government takes its handful and so forth, and then shipped over to Britain, shipped from Britain to Amsterdam or the French ports or the Germanys, all because Britain had a monopoly of American trade. And so Jefferson said, when Britain tried to tax the colonists, said, you know what, if you want to tax us, fine, we'll work out a way. We have to have some representation, but we don't mind paying this money. But in return for that, we want free trade. And Jefferson said, in fact, we'd rather have free trade than not have to pay any taxes to the British government. So there, Robin, you started us off talking about taxation without representation. That was an issue, but Jefferson would tell you, I'd rather pay taxes than what I do now, which is have my tobacco monopolized. So yeah, that's a great point.
Interesting.
Long fibered cotton. Invented.
Oh, the whole long staple cotton. I'm gonna take a pass on that one, Bernie, because that's after my time. Eli Whitney didn't, and Kitty Green didn't invent the cotton gin until 1791, I think.
That's right. But the cotton, in effect, presaged the 1791 cotton gin.
Oh, you remind me of something else, though, because you talked about the British. You know, there was some possibility that the British would come into the Civil War on the southern side, and that would have made sense, talking about realpolitik, because the United States South was the number one source of Britain's cotton, and the cotton textile manufacturing plants, that's the beginning of British industry. That's where British industry comes from, is slave-grown cotton being turned into cloth to be worn by slaves. And so you could see why the South might well have persuaded the British to come into the war on their side. The biggest reason the British could not come into the war on the Southern side was that Lincoln finally turned it into a war against slavery. The South had been fighting for slavery from the beginning, but the North had not been fighting against slavery. The North had only been fighting to save the Union. But with the Emancipation Proclamation, he made it a war against slavery that helped recruit 200,000 Black men to fight for the Union when whites were rioting against being drafted. But I am persuaded by a recent book by a colleague of mine named Don Doyle that the bigger impact of the Emancipation Proclamation was that it kept the British out of the war. And with that great British Navy, they might have tipped the scales in favor of the Confederacy. And so if you ever wonder why the rebels of 1776 succeeded and the rebels of 1861 failed, I'd say the biggest reason was that Lincoln issued a much more categorical Emancipation Proclamation than the one that I mentioned by Dunmore, which it did bring 10,000 African Americans to the British side, but they didn't go full tilt into abolishing slavery because they wanted to keep their own slaves, especially in the Caribbean. And I think that's one explanation for why those two wars, you know, thank goodness in the case of the Civil War, ended so differently from each other.
Well, Das Kapital was paid for by Engels's factories in Manchester.
Yes, that was one of, you know, Dolores mentioned the 1619 Project at the start. I hope you guys get a chance to read that as well. It'll be out in paper pretty soon. I'm astonished that one of the most controversial articles in the 1619 Project, and I'll admit, I don't think this guy made the case as well as you just did, Bernie, but the beginnings of industrial capital are slavery, and that is the cotton textile manufacturing business, where slaves are both supplying the number one or the only import, and they are the number one customers for the product, for those textiles.
I'd have to disagree with that. Enclosure acts of the 17th century had more to do with industrialization and the fine coal in the North Sea, in effect, industrial British manufacturing, in effect, started 200 years earlier. And it also was the migration to Americas, in effect, landless yeomen escaping enclosure.
Well, and we could talk about Native American silver causing massive inflation in the 1500s throughout Europe. So yes, of course, there were a lot of factors, but you know, I like to put up I like to ask my students in my U.S. history survey, what's the first big industry, as in factories, in the United States? And people think railroads, you know, those building those big steam engines, and that was a big thing. But the big industry that's first by human power, of course, and then water power, and then steam power, is those textile mills. I always get in trouble when I say, I didn't mean to say the one factor, and we could argue what's the biggest factor, but at that stage, if I ask the question right, what's the first automated, the first non-human powered industry of any size in both Britain and the United States, it's the cotton textile manufacturing business.
James Watt.
Any more questions or comments from anybody?
I have one, but it's kind of, I think it's not your era that, and I, so I hesitate.
You got Roxanne here. She covers the whole 40,000 year history.
Well,
go ahead.
I got a lot. There are a lot of smart people here. In Ken Burns's Civil War, there was an African American historian, a woman who very, very
Barbara
fervently
Fields.
Stated that Frederick Douglass was the man who convinced Lincoln that he wasn't fighting to unify the country; he was fighting to end slavery.
That was Barbara Fields, who teaches at Columbia. But I think her larger point, I've forgotten, and I'm not even sure I agree about Frederick Douglass in particular, but her larger point was that African-Americans in general liberated themselves before Lincoln started liberating them. It's important to remember that before he issued the Emancipation Proclamation on January 1st, 1863, he revoked a series of earlier Emancipation Proclamations that had been issued by his generals, particularly Fremont, who was the general in charge of Missouri. Remember, Missouri, they call it a border state, but what it really was a loyal slave state. It wanted to stay in the Union and keep its slaves. But my point is, Lincoln comes after the generals, and then the generals come after the slaves, because before generals like Fremont started issuing Emancipation Proclamations, enslaved people on their own, without any encouragement from the Union Army, were escaping their plantations, or we call them slave labor camps today, and going over to the Union Army. And initially they were called contrabands because they were like contraband of war, any other property confiscated from the enemy. And I'd say the person who made the case best for that, I'll send you, email you a copy of the article, Dolores, because that might be really fun for the group, Rob, and I'll send it to Dolores. Might be fun for the group to talk about, but it's W.B. Du Bois. He published a book in 1937, yes, called Black Reconstruction. And one article in it was called The General Strike. And he said that, that document called the Emancipation Proclamation was signed by Abraham Lincoln, but emancipation really came about through the actions of African Americans who transferred their labor from the Southern side, where it was incredibly and importantly valuable for selling cotton. They were still selling cotton to Britain when they could get it there throughout the war, but they transferred their labor from making cotton to make the South able to buy armaments. They transferred that labor to the North, enabling the North to buy armaments and other supplies of war. And that's why he refers to it as a general strike. Du Bois was a proud communist, and he was writing in a period of general strikes at auto plants and so forth. And so you could see why he was being provocative by using that term. But I think it's a good way to look at it, that the slaves basically went on strike in 1861, long before Lincoln got into the picture in 1863. And I'm going to pop that in the email to Dolores right now before I forget, because I love that article. It is amazing. Oh, I'll give you one more line from that, since you, Robin, mentioned Frederick Douglass. Frederick Douglass made a great point about the Civil War. He said, initially, both the North and the South fought for slavery. The South fought to take slavery out of the Union, and the North fought to keep it in. That is, all the North, obviously there were some abolitionists in the North like Frederick Douglass, but all the North as a region of the country, or as a country, all it was fighting for initially was to preserve the Union, which meant keeping slavery in the Union. So initially both sides fought for slavery, the South to take it out and the North to keep slavery in the Union.
Important point.
Kind of so too.
There was a huge colony of ex-slaves who settled in Philadelphia starting in the 1830s and 40s.
Even sooner. Pennsylvania gets credit for being the first state to pass the law abolishing slavery, but with a huge asterisk, because it didn't free a single slave. It said if you're born the day after this law is passed, and then you had to serve an apprenticeship of like 20, 30 years, then you're free. But new slaves could not be brought in. And so you're absolutely right. A lot of African Americans took refuge there, and then their owners would come try to kidnap them and take them back. And really the first anti-slavery organization to include both blacks and whites started as a group to try to stop these kidnappings, because as they were doing this kidnapping, they weren't very discriminating about whether they were capturing ex-slaves or people who had never been slaves and were not even under the laws of their home. I mean, not even under Southern law were slaves. Some of you seen 12 Years a Slave, that man had been born free and captured and sold into slavery. But yeah, Philadelphia was one of the refuges from that until the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850. And that's when many African-Americans had to move further on into Canada, because the North became a hunting ground where the federal government helped enslaved people capture their former slaves and take them back.
There is a tablet in Detroit where John Brown ran the Underground Railroad.
I didn't realize he made it to Detroit.
Was basically a wine grower in Put-in-Bain, Lake Erie, and his connections were to Detroit. And the families which originated through that still live in northern part of the southern peninsula of Michigan, near Cadillac, Michigan, and in central Ontario.
John Brown,
in effect, was better than Custer, who also, unfortunately, originated in Detroit.
Well, you know, John Brown and those who fought with him really do deserve a lot of the credit for the freeing of the slaves. Their own mission obviously was not successful, put down by an American Army, a Marine colonel named Robert E. Lee, back before he committed his treason. But what people often forget is that although unsuccessful, John Brown's raid struck white slaveholders throughout the South with this tremendous fear and created this terrible paranoia. And they viewed the election of Lincoln through that haze of paranoia. I think if it hadn't been for John Brown's raid, the Southern slaveholders, they would have been angry at Lincoln being elected president, but they would have waited to see what he did rather than seceding. You know, in the case of South Carolina, they seceded almost 3 months before he was inaugurated. And that's because of the paranoia that that John Brown and his raiders had created. And there was a massive, there's a book about South Carolina in 1860 called The Crisis of Fear, because even though that happened two states away, the slaveholders all became convinced that their own slaves were also rebelling, and many slaves were murdered in 1860. Because they were suspected of being part of John Brown's conspiracy. And so, you know, he didn't free slaves in the way that he meant to, but he really did so by bringing on the war that brought the end of slavery.
I see a couple more questions in the chat that I've overlooked, and I apologize. One is, can we get copies of your book, and how and when?
Oh, yes. Bookshop.org is a great place to buy it online. Which supports small bookstores. We have a big fight within my family about Amazon, but it is there. but yeah, it's if you just Google "Liberty is Sweet," which I should say, by the way, you can see I have a trick on the in the image on the cover, and I hint at the hidden nature of the history that I'm talking about, or not hint, I tell you it's a hidden history. But even "Liberty is Sweet" is a little bit of a trick, because I want people to think, oh, that must be a quote from Patrick Henry or something. It's not. It's from a statement that George Washington's cousin sent him. The cousin was running Mount Vernon while Washington was off running the Continental Army. And after Dunmore issued his Emancipation Proclamation in 1775, the cousin said, "Sorry, George, but I think a lot of your slaves are gonna run away and join Governor Dunmore. And can you really blame them? Liberty is sweet." And so he was referring to not to the Patriots and their belief that liberty is sweet, but to their slaves and their belief that liberty is sweet.
Interesting. Then there's another question. This is, do you think this conversation would be banned in Florida if DeSantis heard about it?
We absolutely, I'm sorry, the person is kind of kidding, but if we did this in a school, the teacher would be fired in Florida. The school teacher would absolutely be fired, because you could find one white kid in that class to say it made me uncomfortable. And and I don't remember the details of the Florida law, but he picks up a line from an executive order that Trump issued when he was president that Biden rescinded as soon as he became president. And the key word is uncomfortable, if it made anybody feel uncomfortable. And of course, when they say anybody, they mean white people, because Black kids have been feeling uncomfortable since they've been allowed in the schools, because of their history has to make you feel uncomfortable. And so, you know, we want to be precise. If we adults want to have this conversation online, yes, I think we could do this. And there might even be a Floridian having slipped into our conversation, but you absolutely could not do this in a public school in Florida. Now, a lot of these Republicans, it's been noticed in newspapers, a lot of these Republicans banning these conversations in public schools. They send their kids to private schools. And in those private schools, these conversations are often had. You know, some of the most progressive schools where I've spoken are private schools. I'm happen to be a K through 12 public school guy. No, actually, I went to private kindergarten and then K through 12, a 1 through 12 public school guy, 1 through 16, actually, but because I failed 4 years. No, because I went to public college. But I've found some really cool private schools where kids are learning the real truth, including, for instance, Governor Youngkin of Virginia. He sort of modeled himself on DeSantis and tried to mess up the curriculum there by not telling the truth of slavery. And his own kids go to a very progressive private school where they learn, they read books like the 1619 Project. So truth for me, but not for thee.
Woody, before you leave, I'd like to, Bruce, did you want to say, before he leaves, I want to know what inspired you? What made you turn to telling the truth, being a Southerner? And I'm interested in what your father, I guess some people don't know that your father was one of the governors of Virginia and what he did.
Well, you answered your own question about how I got interested in this topic. I've always been interested in history, which I get from both of my parents. My mother was in the CIA and the hard hearing, and actually the OSS. She's still very much alive, and hearing those stories got me interested in the history of the 20th century. And then it wasn't hard to go back from there. And Jefferson, my father was a great lover. He's deceased, a great lover of Jefferson, who did recognize that Jefferson was not a perfect man, but I think we can all recognize that the ideal of all men are created equal was magnificent, if only he and we would live up to it as revised by Elizabeth Cady Stanton. But where my father really, I'll say a bold thing, where my father surpassed Jefferson was that he really did believe in the equality principle. And so when the schools were integrated in Virginia in 1970, I was 10 years old. My sister's a little bit older than that. We'd been going to public schools, but that we'd been going to all white public schools. But the integration order sent us to a school that had previously been all Black, and where we were among the very few white kids to go to those schools, because so many white parents fell for the racist media of the time and racist politicians of the time, and took their kids out and put them in what we call segregated academies and other private schools like that. And so I had what my sisters described as the privilege of being a minority. And for us, it was a privilege. It's not always a privilege to be in a minority. Those of you who are and have been can attest to that. But for us, it really was to get to know kids who were so different from us. We were growing up in the governor's mansion. I counted the halls and the bathrooms and everything, the slave quarters where my sister stayed, much refurbished slave quarters, 45 rooms that mansion had. And a lot of my friends were living in four rooms, in very dilapidated rooms. But we saw our essential sameness as humans, but we also saw our differences. You know, I was one of the first white people to hear about the early origins of rap music because I went to a Black school, and And I really treasured those friendships. And I, so that was the beginning of the seed of me being interested in Black history. And when I got to Duke grad school, people were interested in that topic. I was still interested in the revolution. And so it made sense for me to write about Native and African Americans in the revolution. And there are great books that talk about all of those. Where I really tried to be first was in integrating. So not a chapter on Native Americans and chapter on African Americans and a chapter on women and so forth, but to tell the story the way it really happened, which was all as one story.
Thank you.
Great, thank you.
Terrific. Are there any, Robin, you want to ask it for another round of questions, or you think we should start to wrap this up? This has been an extremely interesting conversation. I've learned a great deal, and this is a lot of people have been asking about the video. Normally, we don't get so many questions about the video, so I think that reflects the fact that people value this conversation very much, and want to see other people have a chance to check this out. So. That video, we will make it available for all of you out there that are have that question. We will make that video available. I'll make sure that it gets, I'll talk to Jonathan, our tech guy, and we'll get it up in the flame. And we do have a lot of other videos. This whole series is being recorded. And though they're available on YouTube. So anyway, that's one thing I want to say.
I was going to suggest that since we had a little bit more time, before 3 o'clock, that if some people in the audience have been dying to ask a question, but just haven't felt they had didn't have the stage. I'm not looking at everybody, I should be. But if any of you have questions that you wanna ask, please, please do.
I should have something.
Well, this is Natalie. So other than the two Martin ladies that you talked about, the one who dressed like a man and with her gun, were there any other significant women that you ran across and maybe talk about in your book?
Suppose I show you a photograph of one of them. Let me pull up my screen again real quick. It's something I didn't get to, there it is, a very little known image of Sarah Osborne, who was living and working in Albany, New York, when she married a man who said, if you'll marry me, I promise my enlistment's almost up and I'll get out of the army and we'll start a farm together. So she married him, and then he completely broke the promise. This was the period of coverture, and so she was stuck with him. But she didn't have to travel. What the law says is not what always happens. And so she didn't have to travel off in the army with him. And so she refused to go until he made an arrangement that she could ride on the cart. And she rode on the cart and then worked with the army. She was at the Battle of Yorktown and claims to have kind of sassed George Washington at one point. He said, be careful, you're going to get shot. She was bringing coffee to soldiers. And Washington said, be careful, you're going to get shot. And she says to Washington, don't worry, no one who is destined for the gallows need fear the bullet, meaning I'm a criminal and I'm going to get hanged someday. That's my destiny. So she was a very sassy lady. But as you see, she lived into the era of photographs. And so this is the only known portrait of a woman who worked with the Continental Army, Sarah Osborne. She, before this photograph was taken, she filed a widow's pension, which a graduate student of mine named Riley Sutherland has been studying hundreds of these women's pension applications after the Revolutionary War. And what Sarah Osborne did, and many of the others did as well, you're supposed to describe what your husband did. You first say what unit he was in and any of that stuff you remember. But, of course, he didn't have good documentation from the 18th century because the pensions didn't become available until 1818. So you have to make up for the lack of documentation by providing detail. So you're supposed to say in detail what battles your husband is in, what role he played, all that stuff. She supplied like five sentences about her husband and then spent the rest of the pension application describing her own enormous contributions to war effort. And Riley, I think, is making a great case in this article, which I hope will appear in a scholarly journal soon. She's got interest from one, makes the case that these women, a lot of these women did that, that this was a way for them to reclaim their own memories of the revolution, that it wasn't just about the guys, but it really was a battle over how they would remember. A lot of people still today, I'll take her down, but a lot, oh no, I wanna show you another image in a second. A lot of people today remember these women as camp followers. And if you Google camp followers, I'm sorry to say, you get- What's that?
It's not a pretty epithet.
Exactly. A lot of people have a negative attitude towards the term camp followers. It's like groupies, you know, today that follow a band around and sleep with the band when they get their chance. It's a negative thing. Well, here's the first thing that Riley found out was that the term camp follower was never used at the time in America. It actually comes from the British Army in India. And it only got applied to people like Sarah Osborne in the 19th century. And I'm sorry to say that our favorite authors like James Fenimore Cooper disparaged camp followers, although some of their positive qualities came out, but they did start portraying them as prostitutes, as dirty, as useless and all these things. But if you go to the records of the time from male officers, as well as these women's pension applications, you see their real usefulness. And I'll give you a classic example. This is not something that Sarah Osborne did, but many women did, was they served as laundresses. And that's, socially speaking, the bottom of the totem pole. But once George Washington inoculated his army against smallpox, the biggest killer of soldiers, of course, it's not bombs and bullets. That won't happen until World War I or World War II. The biggest killer was typhus. And the biggest spreader of typhus is lice in shirts. And so when the women of the army, so we prefer to call them army women, not camp followers, when the army women boiled water and washed shirts, they killed lice and they were saving lives just as much as a man might be if he jumped on a grenade. And the laundresses recognized their value so much that when they were denied their rations, or other things they'd been promised, we know of at least three examples where they went on strike. And so they have a fascinating role in the war. And it's not just white women like Sarah Osborne, but we know of at least one Native woman who applied for a pension application, applied for a pension because of service that she'd provided to the Continental Army and received not cash that she'd asked for, but land. So this weird dynamic of the United States granting land to a Shawnee woman and an African-American woman. Here's an example of an African-American woman named Sue. I didn't jot down the date of this. I think it's 1778 that this woman escaped her owner, Edward Hand, who was a general in the the American Army, but she escaped his home and went to join a different unit of the American Army. And if I'm right, that 1778, by that time, a lot of the men in the Continental Army, not the majority, but a lot of them were deserting. The Continental Army hadn't kept up its promise in terms of pay and rations and all those other things. And so they were freeing themselves by running away from the American Army. Well, what Sue, who didn't have a last name at the time, what she did was free herself by running to the army. This old typography, about two-thirds of the way through, I'll read that sentence. It is supposed, you know, they have the old F that looked like I'm sorry, the old S.
Yes. Yeah.
It looks like an F. It is suspected she went to camp with a white woman commonly called Captain Molly. And some of you may have heard of Captain Molly, Molly Pitcher. Now, Molly Pitcher is a sort of an aggregate picture of all of these women who helped fight in the Revolutionary War. There was some woman who, as you see, whose husband was a dragoon, that is a horseman. And she and Sue formed a little alliance of their own. You know, we know of lots of white women enslavers who were as horrible to the people they enslaved as the men were, but one woman, but there are also other examples of black and white women who could cooperate. And here's an example of that.
That's fascinating.
I don't have as much in my book as my student who I've met after the book was pretty much, she ended up doing wonderful, because I didn't do much of it myself. She did a wonderful population table for the book, which is the first population table. Sorry to you Californians, it stops at the Mississippi River, but it's the first one to estimate population for all the native nations east of the Mississippi River, as well as all the British colonies and all of the colonies in the Caribbean, of Spanish and French and Dutch and so forth as well. I also have, Roxanne mentioned Jeff Osler. He produced the first map of all of the native nations in America. And I tried to take it one step further by having the first map of east of the Mississippi that has all the native nations and their boundaries and major towns in the native nations, because I wanted to combat a myth that Ben Franklin and others spread. Ben Franklin, I'm sorry to say, referred to Native Americans as scatterloping, that is wandering around, but they didn't scatterlope. Yes, they often migrated, like maybe some of you, or no one on the West Coast has to do this, but there's a lot of people on this coast who are snowbirds, who live in Michigan in the summer, in Florida in the winter. Unfortunately, they vote in Florida, but a lot of native nations did that. It makes a lot of sense in this climate, also in terms of the game that you're going after. Anyway, so they didn't scatterlope though. They had two homes, and just as that wouldn't justify me taking away somebody's home in Florida or their home in Michigan, that doesn't justify what was done to indigenous people. But my point is that they had towns, and so I thought it was important to show their populations and their towns rather than just the West, or the old maps just would kind of have the word Cherokee written vaguely out there with no towns and no sense of boundaries. Of course, their boundaries were disputed, just as European and African boundaries were.
Wow.
Amazing. Amazing, really. Amazing thing.
We have now reached past three, and I'm afraid we're taking advantage of Woody here by questioning.
No, you're not. I'm enjoying it, but I think for everyone else's sake, it's probably time to go. But I've sure enjoyed the discussion.
Everybody here enjoyed this discussion. I'm gonna wrap it up right now. I want to thank you so much, Woody, for coming, and thank everybody else who was on this call as well. I want to encourage everybody, as I said before, to pass the word, not only about this and get the video out to other people, but also about this series, Dangerous Truth. Tell your friends about it. Tell everybody you know that we
have many there
on, and encourage them to be part of it. We're going to be getting together again on June 19th at 1 p.m. That's a Sunday. And at that point, Robert J. Miller, I think Dolores already mentioned it, professor of law at Lewis and Clark Law School in Oregon, and a citizen of the Eastern Shawnee Tribe of Oklahoma, will speak on his latest book, Native America. Native America, Discovered and Conquered, Thomas Jefferson, Lewis and Clark, and Manifest Destiny. Whoa, that's a lot of stuff right there. And that's, you know, this is sort of continuing on. These conversations, we're trying to cover sort of historically the progression of U.S. history, and again, bringing out the truths that normally are suppressed, especially as Woody has mentioned, in schools, and all of us can testify from our own educations that we didn't learn any of this stuff in school. I personally went through in the 50s, and it was, you know, a dead zone when it came to history, U.S. But anyway, we had to learn this stuff, you know, afterwards. I think there's a lot more. I really appreciate the historians, by the way. I myself do some, do a lot of reading in history because I do some writing on this stuff. And historians are the unsung heroes, really. They're bringing up this stuff that needs to be brought up. They're popularizing it. And, you know, it's up to all of us to try to get those ideas out there, because it's the only way we're going to have a decent society, a liberated society, is if we understand right. Our history.
Right on.
So anyway, I just want to mention real briefly that after the next program, which is June 19th, Sunday, 1 p.m., the following month on July 31st, we're going to have Amy Greenberg, who's going to be talking about the war against Mexico, which is another very significant part of U.S. history, which often gets hidden and buried purposely, you know, not talked about, but very important in understanding our common history. And so I want to encourage people that we'll be sending out information on both those events coming up. And I think that's about it, unless somebody else, Dolores or Robin or Dave or anybody else have anything they want to throw in the last minute here. Otherwise, we'll close this out with.
Thank you.
Lovely. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Woody.
Yeah, I really appreciate it. Keep up the good work, guys.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. We're going to close this out. I am looking for something here that I'm supposed to do a screen share.
Thank you, Roxanne.
Yeah, thank you, Roxanne. Thank you.
Wake up, Lord, thanks for setting us up.
We'll do. Sleeping in
bed. Okay. No, everybody have a good day. Good evening. Good night.
The world has changed so very much.
Bye now.
What it used to be. There's so much hatred, war, and poverty. Wake up all the teachers, time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say. They're the ones who's coming up and the world is in their hands. When you teach the children, teach them the very best you can. Just let it be.